Everyone, please welcome to the stage Tana Clues, CEO of the New Hampshire Women's Foundation.
Good afternoon. Welcome to the 18th annual Women Building Community Luncheon. I think it's safe to say that we've missed being together. It is so wonderful to see all of you back here today. I never imagined 3 years ago that I wouldn't see your faces the following year, or the year after that. I can't really believe how long 3 years has been. It feels like a lifetime, maybe two lifetimes. The world has changed, and yet here we are. We are back, or as they say at Star Islands, we did come back, we did come back, we did come back. I'm so grateful to have you all here today, building community and supporting the Women's Foundation. This event would not be possible without the generosity and hard work of many, so let's take a few moments to offer thanks. First, our sincere thanks to our presenting sponsor, Dartmouth Health. To our grantee showcase sponsor, Dr. Jeff and Senator Martha Fuller Clark. Our She Change sponsors, Jill Schiffman and Hope Damon. And our gold sponsors, Impax Asset Management, Lovering Auto Group, New Hampshire Charitable Foundation, Revision Energy, Northeast Delta Dental, and Alumni Ventures. And our silver and advocate sponsors, all of whom are listed in your program and up on our screens. Thank you. Thank you to my New Hampshire Women's Foundation colleagues, Karen, Crystal, Ellen, Devin, Colin, Dow, Laura Lee, and Sam. We did remember how to do an event in person again, thank God. And we are so proud of you for the seamless event you've put on. And my sincere thanks to the Board of Directors of the Women's Foundation. I remain grateful for your commitment of being a bold and powerful voice for women and girls in the Granite State. And of course, the many, many women who are woven into the fabric of this organization's DNA. Founders and members of the Women's Fund, the Women's Policy Institute, the Women's Lobby, the Commission on the Status of Women, and the Women's Initiative. We continue to stand on your shoulders, and we hope we are making you proud. You may have noticed that there are a few fewer program books. That was both intentional and not intentional. I think I left a box in Portsmouth, but we were trying to cut back. So let's trial by fire. So share your programs, save a few trees. We hope you'll share photos from the event today online using the hashtag NHWFWBC and tag us too. And visit our merchandise table out front where we have lots of great t-shirts and swag. And as you may have noticed, as I'm proudly calling the Squash Your Rage at the Patriarchy squish ball, I think we could all use an outlet to our rage, so make sure you take this home. We have some elected officials here with us this morning, and we're honored to have them here. We have Congresswoman Annie McLean Custer. We have Congressman Chris Pappas. We have Executive Counselor Cindy Warmington. And Manchester's own Mayor Joyce Craig. We also have many, many additional elected officials, activists who are working on our behalf, who are running for office, and some of them are running for the very first time. So could everyone who is either in office or running for office please stand so we can thank you for your service. And we have a group of people who I am particularly honored to welcome today. Our grantees, who have been on the ground doing the hard work in communities across the state, serving women, girls, and families of the Granite State. These organizations delivered on their missions despite the many obstacles COVID threw their way. Some of them were even persistently threatened with defunding because of the reproductive health care services they provide. And yet all of these organizations adapted to the changing landscape in order to deliver their services. We are honored to recognize our 2020, 2021, and 2022 New Hampshire Women's Foundation grantees. If you would all please stand. I was saying earlier today, and I'll say again, that I can't help but think back to my first Women Building Community Luncheon as CEO, my first day on the job, the morning after the 2016 election. Many of you were here that day, and I heard from so many of you that the only thing that got you out of bed that morning was coming here, was being together in person. You shared your fear, your pain, your outrage, your shock. And the weight of that uncertain moment in history was palpable then, and I would say this year, it's palpable right now. The Supreme Court's decision to overturn Roe v. Wade in June, although not unexpected, was a punch to the gut. That we find ourselves facing a future with fewer rights, again, we feel that presence of an unprecedented moment. That the Supreme Court, for the first time, issued a ruling that removed an established right of American citizens. Just last month, a national abortion ban was introduced in Congress, and its future will be decided by the results of the election in 12 days. P.S. Have you registered to vote? Are your neighbors and children registered to vote? And here in New Hampshire last year, the state's most restrictive abortion ban in history became law. The New Hampshire Women's Foundation supports full access to reproductive health care for all who need it. And we believe women and people who can become pregnant should have access to the full range of reproductive health care, including birth control, abortion, pre- and post-nasal care, and gender-affirming health care. Access to many of those freedoms are on the line. And our work at the Women's Foundation is more urgent than ever. And sadly, as we all know, both nationwide and in our own state, we are seeing an alarming rise, not just of sexism and racism, but anti-Semitism, white supremacy, homophobia, and transphobia. We stand against these systems of oppression and will continue to persist with all of you for a more inclusive future. Thank you for standing with us as we fight against this oppression. We have an incredible program for you today. You're going to hear from our She Change awardee, some boundary-breaking athletes, and so much more. Today, we're celebrating the 50th anniversary of Title IX, the legislation that prohibited discrimination on the basis of sex for any federally funded institution. Most of us know Title IX as the law that opened up sports to women and girls, but of course, it encompassed so much more than that, and we look forward to our conversation about the legacy, its legacy and its future of Title IX with our special guests, Penny Pitou, CeCé Telfer, and Sharyn Potter. Now, let's continue with our program, and I'm honored to welcome to the stage one of my absolute favorite people, a gender justice champion, member of the board of directors, dad, who, by the way, multitasks like the best of them, and co-owner of Revision Energy, Dan Weeks.
Good afternoon, friends. Thank you, Tana. Such an honor. Isn't it good to be together again? Hooray for that. I'll just say, quick disclaimer, this was not quite the plan this morning, but I have a feeling a few folks in the audience know how it goes. My wife is teaching. School is out today. The bravest of my bunch, our little girl, is sitting at the table herself. Maybe she'll come forward. But what an honor to be here, and what a joy to be back together to celebrate the anniversary of the landmark Title IX legislation. Tana asked me to reflect really briefly on what that means to me. Grew up as a boy, got to have all the sporting opportunities that I could ever wish for. My wife and I got lucky in that we got a girl and a boy on the first try, and then another little boy. My parents had to wait till their fourth try to get a girl. There were three boys and then a girl. And in more recent years, as we were leaving home, friends, when they found out we had three boys and a girl, would often ask me, well, you know, what about your little sister, your baby sister, and weren't you protective of her, and weren't you worried about her going off into the world? And I could answer confidently, and to this day would certainly say the same, in part thanks to Title IX and her incredible athletic abilities. She always competed against us, her three older brothers, and often out-competed us in sports and had all those opportunities at our high school down in Peterborough, New Hampshire. She was able to realize her gifts and become the tough, fierce competitor that she naturally is and apply that on the sports field and in life, making her way strongly and successfully. And I haven't made the connection very often to Title IX, but in retrospect, I think it's pretty clear to me the fact that she had opportunities that earlier generations didn't, and if we don't stay vigilant, that future generations of young girls may not to the same extent because of what we're seeing, the threats to our fundamental freedoms from the Supreme Court. That's worth fighting for, and that's meant a lot in our family, and I'm thrilled that my strong little girl at the table has the same opportunities as these little boys, and we gotta protect these rights. In any case, I'm pleased to welcome Dartmouth Health, our presenting sponsor. Dartmouth Health, for those who don't know, has been an incredible partner and supporter of the Women's Foundation. Led by their CEO and president, Dr. Joanne Conroy, they share our values of expanding opportunity for women and girls, and we are grateful to have such a strong partnership with Joanne and her team, and proud of the work they do delivering high-quality health care, including reproductive health, to all who need their services. And so, it's my pleasure to introduce the System Vice President for Communications and Marketing at Dartmouth Health, and my colleague on the New Hampshire Women's Foundation Board, Jennifer Gilkey.
Good afternoon, thank you. It is so good to be here in person. As both Dartmouth Health's System Vice President of Communications and Marketing and as a very proud board member of the New Hampshire Women's Foundation. Women's rights are human rights, and reproductive care rights are health care. Dartmouth Health is proud to be the presenting sponsor of the 18th annual New Hampshire Women's Foundation Luncheon, Women Building Community, and celebrating 50 years of Title IX. We're honored to be here today to celebrate your work and to reinforce our commitment to weave world-class care into the fabric of our community. Dartmouth Health remains unwavering in its belief in the sanctity of the patient-physician relationship and to making the best informed decisions for patients to reflect their needs and healthcare priorities. We also believe that abortion is an essential component of healthcare. Like all medical matters, personal, individual decisions regarding abortion should be made by patients in consultation with their trusted healthcare providers. This is a time most of us never thought we'd have to experience. Never did I imagine the seismic shift in healthcare decision-making. For 50 years, the Supreme Court decision Roe v. Wade has affirmed a woman's right as settled law to make her own choice around her health, including the termination of a pregnancy, and has allowed medical personnel in medically accepted settings to legally carry out abortions. With the loss of this freedom and state-by-state legislation, to protect or restrict patients' rights, there will likely be serious health impacts on our communities, including the training and supply of obstetricians, badly needed obstetricians, and gynecologists. While the discussions and activism around this case took place in primarily legal and political arenas, it's really important to remember that this is, first and foremost, a medical matter. And as an academic health system, we are deeply concerned around the downstream effects of this ruling, not only on our provision of care, but also on the education and training of healthcare providers. I am reminded, growing up in the 60s and 70s, of overhearing my father and grandfather discussing Boston's Lockover restaurant, who had at last, if you can believe it, in 1970, decided to allow women to dine there. I am not kidding. I remember listening to my mother and grandmother cheering about Roe v. Wade and hearing at school from one of my teachers that Title IX had been enacted and what it would mean for women and girls in sports. Title IX meant that we were taking the first steps to a level playing field in sports. We still have a long way to go, but Title IX was a start. And yes, I am proud and old enough to know all the lyrics to Helen Reddy's I Am Woman, from hearing it played on the radio and sung along to by my mother as she drove her 1970 lime green Dodge Dart. Now, as I think about my 17-year-old daughter growing up in a world where her health care could be decided not by a physician, but by a politician, I reach to find my voice and to make it powerful. I want my daughter's voice to be powerful too. And I look at these absolutely inspirational and spirited girls who have joined us today and are sitting here, and I know that they are depending on those of us who are just a little bit older, who are here in this room, women, people of all ages, diversity and backgrounds, to support them, to lead the way through our actions and voices, just as our grandmothers, mothers, friends, mentors did for us. I grew up believing that my rights were inalienable and that I could do anything, and be in control of my healthcare decisions. Thus far in my lifetime, that has been true for me. But I worry about the future, so I say to all of those amazing young women, you can be anything and you must use your voices. As Helen Reddy wrote and sang, you can bend but never break me because it only serves to make me more determined to achieve my final goal. And I come back even stronger, not a novice any longer, because you've deepened the conviction in my soul. I am woman. I am invincible, I am strong, I am woman. I look around this room and I see a multi-generational we, New Hampshire's unbreakable, determined, achieving women, people of all genders, deeply convinced to their souls that the comeback time is now. We are women, we are people of all genders. We work together to build community. And while we celebrate today, we also know there is much left to do. November 8th is coming. Thank you.
Please welcome to the stage, Ellen Koenig.
Hello, everyone. And first of all, I'm really pleased that I got up the stairs with the glass award and have not yet broken it. So I'm off to a good start. I'm Ellen Koenig. And I'm the director of grant making for the New Hampshire Women's Foundation. And a special hello to all of our grantee partners out there. It's so wonderful to see so many of you. And I'm lucky because our goal is to support our nonprofit partners, not only with grant dollars, but also with our ability to showcase their work and tell their stories. The She Change Award, which we are about to present, is a great opportunity for us to share the work of a strong and innovative organization with all of you. This year, as a concrete way to demonstrate the impact of Title IX, we're recognizing Girls on the Run for the great work they do. You wait to hear from them. You're gonna love it. Every year, they work with upwards of 2,000 girls across the state, engaging them in a 10-week curriculum, which is designed to inspire all girls to build confidence while fostering care and compassion for themselves and others. Several years ago, I wanted to see what this was all about, and I attended the 5K run in Concord, which is the capstone of their work. I was amazed at what I saw. Hundreds of girls, all shapes and sizes, in all kinds of crazy outfits, colorful tutus, wild hats, scarves, running towards the finish line, usually with a parent or a coach or a friend running alongside them, cheering them on. The grins on their faces showed the pride that each girl had in her ability to finish what she started and do something she didn't think she could do weeks before that. Cross that finish line, knowing more about her own strengths and abilities and how to work through challenges. At the end of the race, the huge balloon arch that waits for the runners at the end says it all. The finish line is just the beginning. And with that, I introduce the amazing executive director of Girls on the Run, Jennifer Hubble.
Okay, here we are. First, I must say a special thank you to Ellen, because when she called me a month or so ago and shared this news, I was very emotional, as was she. So I think we're having that little moment again. So thank you so much to Ellen, Tana, and the New Hampshire Women's Foundation for honoring Girls on the Run New Hampshire with this award. Your continued support, not just as a funder of our work, but also by bringing us together with other Women's Foundation grantees through your nonprofit roundtables, has just been so enriching and wonderful. I first came to Girls on the Run in 2003. Oh, there are my friends. Hi. As a volunteer coach in Stratum. Then in 2007, I became executive director and have had the privilege of leading this organization in the past 15 years, doing work that really matters, work that is so rewarding. Through our program, I've seen girls make new friends, build valuable life skills, discover a love of running and movement, build confidence, and tap into that inner star power. Once you've witnessed something that transformative of an impact, it's hard to imagine doing anything else. For those of you who haven't experienced it, Girls on the Run inspires the next generation of leaders through a 10-week program that teaches critical life skills in a supportive environment. Any young person from third grade to eighth grade, ages 8 to 13, who identifies as a girl, regardless of their ability or athletic experience, can join a small team of 15 to 20 girls, led by amazing trained volunteer coaches. Some of them are here today. Lots of them are here today. Our research-based curriculum is, of course, about running, but truly it's about empowerment. The bi-weekly team activities cover everything from emotional literacy to healthy habits and help them connect with one another. They develop language around their very important emotions and instill the importance of kindness and joy. In addition to these interactive lessons and physical activities that are woven throughout the program, each team comes up with a fun community impact project that is completely girl-driven. Everything from a canned food drive for a local food shelter, a food pantry, to baking dog biscuits for a local animal shelter. Fun stuff. So we host two seasons every single year, one in the fall and one in the spring. And each of these culminates with a 5K celebration. It's not a race, it's a celebration. And it isn't your average 5K. Many of you have been to one. As Ellen mentioned, our event is non-competitive, filled with joy and inspiration, crazy socks and butterfly wings, face painting, ladybug ears. It is a true celebration of all that the girls have learned from their experience. This fall season, our 5K is coming up next month in Concord. We have 729 girls participating this season on 48 teams with 170 volunteer coaches. At the 5K, each girl can bring one running buddy to accompany them. The focus is never on winning, but on doing their very best that day. That's why at every 5K, every girl wears a number one race bib. So fun. One of our mottos is the finish line is just the beginning. Accomplishing their goal of completing a 5K is a really big deal. And it becomes a jumping off point of self-confidence that our participants will take with them the rest of their lives. So you're all here today to celebrate the anniversary of Title IX. So I know this is a room full of people who understand the enormous positive impact that the ability to participate in sports offers for young people, especially girls. I see it every day in the impact of our program. It goes way beyond physical benefits, equipping the girls to become confident, healthy, joyful women. If you're excited about our work, and how can you not be? I want to invite you to get involved. I know there are many people in this room who would make excellent Girls on the Run coaches. Our coaches act as role models and mentors and team leaders. You do not need to be a runner, I promise you. We provide our coaches with all the training and materials you would need to succeed. So maybe you could volunteer at our 5K or donate some granola bars to a local team. We're all across New Hampshire. You might even be able to connect a young girl with our program. We are for all girls. There are many ways to get involved with our work. But the best part of Girls on the Run is that it's not just important and life-changing and inspiring. It's also a lot of fun. And I have some friends here with me today to prove it. We have our team from Bakersville School right here in Manchester, joining me now on the stage.
Oh, So there's more. There's more. These awesome superstar, sparkly, shiny girls are going to show you their very favorite energy award. But let me explain what an energy award is. At the end of every practice, an energy award is given to a girl who has exhibited positive girls on the run behavior that day, such as encouraging her teammates, persevering, or showing gratitude. So I think the one that the girls want to lead us through, or first show you, it's called the mango. All right, Coach Zibble. We're ready. Form the mango, form the mango. Peel the mango, peel the mango. Eat the mango, eat the mango. Do the tango, do the tango. Okay. And lastly, the final part, the very last part of every single Girls on the Run lesson is doing our infamous cheer. And when, not yet, when I say go, when I say 4, 3, 2, 1, what do the girls say? First whisper it. Girls on the Run is so much fun. All right, so let's see if the crowd can join us too. You ready? Okay. 4, 3, 2, 1. Girls on the Run is so much fun. Let's do it again. 4, 3, 2, 1.
Girls on the
Run is so much fun. 4, 3, 2, 1. Thank you. All right, wait. Come back. No, I didn't mean not to do the picture. Here we go. Come on. Come on. Just not with me in it. Go ahead. Go ahead.
Aren't they amazing? So before we break for lunch, P.S., you've already all eaten lunch, so it's going to be a very, very short break. We wanted to take just a moment to let you know that our good friend Ellen Koenig is retiring at the end of this year. I'm already emotional, but we're going to celebrate her more in December. But since this is her last Women Building Community Luncheon, I'd like to invite up Hope Damon, who is our chair of our grant-making committee, to say a few words about Ellen.
Hello, everyone. I gotta say, I've never stood up here at this podium, and I get goosebumps when I'm sitting down at this event. Also, following Girls on the Run, really? How are you supposed to do that? Except my dear friend, Ellen. For at least 10 years, I've had the incredible honor of working alongside and learning from Ellen Koenig. It is a true privilege to offer this tribute to an extraordinary person. Ellen has a well-earned statewide reputation, including, but certainly not limited, to her work with the New Hampshire Women's Foundation since 2014. Some of her other notable roles have included her time at the New Hampshire Charitable Foundation and the New Hampshire Center for Nonprofits. If you've been to Star Island recently, you may have heard her soothing voice and benefited from her knowledgeable presence as a docent. Many of you have had the pleasure of working with Ellen in one or more of her significant roles with New Hampshire's leading nonprofits. So you know that Ellen is simply the best. Her kind spirit, her endless wisdom, her calm demeanor, her wit, and her incredible organizational skills have been a gift to anyone that she comes in contact with. The inimitable way that Ellen is able to connect with anyone, combined with her skill of communicating the impact of programs that serve women and girls in New Hampshire, are unmatched. Despite all of her skills, Ellen is far more likely to be complimenting someone else or drawing them out than acknowledging her expertise. Women's Foundation Grants Committee, which I'm co-chair of, operates with a very collaborative consensus model. We attract smart, determined, capable reviewers to our grants team, also known as lots of mostly women with very strong voices. Ellen's ability to coordinate our work is like verbal choreography. Ellen is the Alpha to Ailey of facilitating. Behind the scenes of Ellen's professional skill and impact is my dear friend and a friend to many. Every week, while I was being treated for cancer, Ellen sent an encouraging note every single week. And I know that I am one of many that she cares for in that quiet, thoughtful way. We have a few more months to savor working with our dear colleague, including an opportunity in December to properly celebrate her legacy of service to our state. But please, join me right now in thanking Ellen for all that she has given to the Women's Foundation community on behalf of the girls and women of New Hampshire. Thank you, Ellen.
Thank you, everyone. I'm honored and humbled. Thank you.
And that is so Ellen, humbled.
All right, for anyone who has not eaten, it's time to eat, and we'll come back around soon. If you have eaten, I'm sure you can steal somebody's dessert. We'll see you in a few minutes.
And so we'd like to welcome to the stage Martha Fuller Clark, the Vice Chair for the New Hampshire Women's Foundation Board of Directors.
And I just wanted to say, you know, there are more than 500 women that are here today, and it is a real honor to have the time to share with you and also to be able to speak to you. So thank you very, very much for all the support that you give the Women's Foundation. And just as a reminder, if you need to be reminded, make sure that you vote. Yeah. So many of you know that I have the honor of serving on the board of directors of the Women's Foundation, but I wanted to speak about my time in the legislature, where I learned early that there was no way we could advance the issues and priorities of women and girls in New Hampshire without broad bipartisan support, working in coalitions with those willing to come together for good policies, particularly my fellow women colleagues of all parties. And that's why I'm so proud of our Women's Run program. You may not be aware, but it is the only nonpartisan program in the state empowering and training women to run for office. I want you to hear that again. It is the only nonpartisan program in the state empowering and training women to run for office. And you should be inspired as I am that this year's Women Run cohort have all won their primaries and are now in the final days of their campaigns. I'm sure they would appreciate your support. and I thank them all for stepping up to serve their communities. And for all of you who are here today, I encourage you to think about your commitment to the goals and objectives of the Women's Foundation, whether it's through introducing our work to your friends and associates, perhaps by sending them a recent issue of our Gender Matters or Status of Women's Report, and also asking women you know to run for office, because what we hear so often is that women don't think of running for office until they're asked to do so. And so you can be a great sort of leverage point by asking women to run for office. And obviously also opening your checkbooks. We are at a critical juncture in history. Commitment to equity is more important than ever. And I'm seeing a future where my granddaughters, and I have a brand new granddaughter, she was born 2 days ago. Her name is Nike, that's for victory. And so I'm worried about a future where she might not have the rights that you and I have had as women. The only way we'll keep that from happening is through leadership that will protect what we have fought for and continue to advance equitable policies in our state. It all has to start with strong data. My female colleagues in the legislature and I learned early on that if you didn't have the data, that no matter what you were fighting for, you could not be effective. My male colleagues used to say, "Show me the data." And at the time, it just wasn't being collected. We didn't have it to share. My colleagues and I decided to create the Women's Policy Institute, one of the predecessor organizations of the Women's Foundation, to conduct research and collect the data on women and girls in New Hampshire, so we could bring about the change that was so clearly needed. This commitment to reliable data has continued with the Women's Foundation till today. And I want you to know that here at this luncheon, we are excited to share the news of the PAX scholarship, which will support our research program and make permanent our research fellow position. Funding this role in perpetuity ensures that we will continue to have reliable data to support policies that advance equity in New Hampshire. So I am more than thrilled to introduce my friend and colleague, Joe Keefe, president of Impact Assets Management, to tell us more about the PAX scholarship. Great show. Joe, thank you so much for stepping up with this important investment.
Thank you, Martha. Good afternoon, everyone. As Martha just mentioned, we're just now going to be launching an annual PAX scholarship to support the New Hampshire Women's Foundation. I just want to give you a little context. I'm in the program as president of Impact's Asset Management. Before that, we were called PAX World. And PAX World, in 1971, right here in New Hampshire, in Portsmouth, launched the very first mutual fund in the United States that integrated social and environmental criteria, in addition to traditional financial criteria, in investing on behalf of our shareholders. Over the following decades, we introduced a lot of additional funds and strategies, including the very first gender lens fund in the United States, the PAX Elevate Global Women's Leadership Fund, which focuses on investing in companies globally that are leaders in advancing women and in advancing gender equality. That legacy is a powerful one, but 4 years ago, we were purchased by a company in London called Impact Management, which is almost the same as PAX, and we became Impact, and we continue to invest in the transition to a more sustainable economy. We continue to integrate environmental and social factors into all our investments, and we continue to focus on investing in women and in gender equality. But we just announced very recently that we are now going to be changing the name of the PACS funds to Impacts as well. And we wanted to do something to honor the legacy, that 51-year legacy of PACS. And so we're starting an annual scholarship program that will go on in perpetuity. And we wanted to do something that would honor PACS's legacy in its home here in New Hampshire. So we're going to be supporting annually three New Hampshire organizations, the Peter Paul School of Business and Economics at UNH, to focus on a student who is focused in their studies on sustainable finance. Friends Forever International, which works with communities around the globe to build the leadership abilities of young people from diverse backgrounds to tackle local and global issues. And then finally, the third one, we're going to support the New Hampshire Women's Foundation. Is sustainable finance, global peace, and advancing women and gender equality have been our core focus for a while. Thank you. And so this scholarship for the New Hampshire Women's Foundation will support the research program and will annually support a research fellow. And this, you know, as all of you know, the New Hampshire Women's Foundation has a flagship publication now, I think you could call it, The Status of Women in New Hampshire, which is the most comprehensive compilation of data on women in New Hampshire, The Status of Girls, which is the most comprehensive compilation of data and research on the status of girls and their well-being in New Hampshire, and Gender Matters, a quarterly that is published four times a year on issues ranging from birth control to girls' mental health to abortion rights in New Hampshire, and all kinds of other issues that are critical to advancing women and girls in our state. And so we're happy to be able to fund that research fellow on an annual basis. We know that New Hampshire Women's Foundation is the trusted source for research and data on these issues, and we're glad to be able to help do that. And as Gender Matters' motto is, when you know the facts, you can act. And we hope by helping people know the facts, we can help all of us act to advance women and girls in New Hampshire and advance gender equality. So with that, thank you. We're really, really honored to be able to support this organization on an annual basis through the PACS Scholarship. And with that, I will call back up my dear Freight Seacoast friend, Tana Clues. Thank you.
This year marks, as you know, this year marks the 50th anniversary of Title IX, prohibiting sex discrimination in educational institutions that receive federal funding. It is a crucial part of our country's civil rights legacy. As the first person in my family to go to college, partly because of Title IX, I know firsthand the opportunities made possible by this landmark legislation. Hundreds of thousands of women and girls have gained opportunities because of Title IX. But one study this year found that 87% of colleges and universities are still not offering athletic opportunities to women proportionate to their enrollment. And as we have seen in recent months, even long-standing established protections cannot be taken for granted. Amidst new attacks on Title IX, it is more important than ever that we understand our history and what's at stake with the future of non-discrimination protections. We are honored to be joined today by three New Hampshire women who are eminently qualified to discuss the topic, including two barrier-breaking world-class athletes and a Title IX expert. You're going to get a chance to hear from each of them, and then we're going to have a short conversation on stage. Many of you need no introduction to Penny Pitou. In 1955, at age 16, Penny astonished the ski world by winning the slalom, downhill, and alpine combined championships at the Junior Alpine Championships in Whitefish, Montana. The next year, Penny was named to the U.S. ski team for the Winter Olympics in Italy. She went on to have several successful seasons with the U.S. ski team, competing at the 1956 Winter Olympics and gaining a reputation on the European circuit as one of the world's top skiers. In 1959, Penny began to win downhills and giant slaloms with frequency and was a gold medal favorite at Squaw Valley in 1960, where she just missed the gold in two races. Here's a look at Penny in the 1960 Squaw Valley Olympics.
Yvonne Rupp was up against home favorite Penny Pitou for gold. Rupp from Switzerland snaked her way through a course laid out with 57 gates. Rupp produced a smooth run to finish with the fastest time so far. Pitou was left to do the chasing. Once again, she felt the pressure of being home favorite in the event. She crossed the finish line only 1/10 of a second behind Rupp and had to settle for a second silver medal. Bing Crosby, yet another movie star visitor, chatted to Penny Pitou.
You know, I have to say I'm pretty happy they don't cover women's sports like that anymore. Could you imagine that music as Michaela Schifrin goes down the mountain? After retiring from competition, Penny began to run ski schools in New England, served as a fashion consultant, as she should, to the ski industry, and started Penny Pitou Travel, one of the largest travel agencies in New England, which specializes in arranging ski trips and tours to Europe. I could go on and on about Penny's accomplishments and accolades, but perhaps most near and dear to us is that Penny was a founder of the Women's Fund in New Hampshire, one of our predecessor organizations. Please join me in welcoming New Hampshire's own Olympic champion, Penny Pitou.
Thank you very much, Tana. And I'm really happy I didn't trip and fall on my face on the way up here. This has been quite an afternoon, and I've loved seeing all some old friends. And I want to thank all of you for being here, and I want to thank the New Hampshire Women's Foundation for inviting me to be here to celebrate the 50th anniversary of Title IX. Title IX was passed in the 70s, long after my school days were over. I grew up building tree houses and running through the mountains with the boys in my village and never thought I couldn't do anything they could do. In high school, I disguised myself as a boy to join the ski team, and that worked fine. I was second man on the team. Until one day, while racing in New Hampton school in a giant slalom, I was headed toward a gate going much too fast. I caught an edge. I fell flat on my face. My hat came off. My hair fell out. And the gatekeeper looked down and said, "Oh my God, it's a girl." Soon after, I was called into the principal's office, surely to congratulate me on doing so well on the team, I expected. But no, Mr. Piper informed me that I was off the team. Some parents had complained that I was on the bus with the boys without a chaperone. Now, I'd grown up with these boys, and now I couldn't ride the bus with them because I was a girl? I didn't let that stop me and went on to ski in many races in the East and West, including the Junior and Senior Nationals, and of course, the Olympics. But I still faced barriers because of my gender. The year after my first Olympics in Cortina d'Ampezzo, Italy, back home in my senior year in high school, I approached our school's track and field coach, and I said to Mr. Smith, "You know, I'm pretty strong. I've been working with my father in the woods, chopping down trees, no chainsaws in those days, and cutting up the wood for the fireplaces. I also mow lawns with a push mower. I have lots of upper body strength. Would you show me how to put the shot and throw the discus?" He looked at me and said, "Nope, you're a girl. Girls don't do that." We girls heard that a lot back then. Years later, when I was a young mother in Guilford, my neighbor's daughter, Amy, a very talented baseball player, came up the hill crying and told me they wouldn't let her play Little League baseball because she was a girl. Well, I marched her right down to the village field. There were six diamonds, all being used by boys. I walked Amy up to the first diamond coach and I said, "This is Amy Richardson. She wants to play ball." "Well, she can't because she's a girl. But Amy can throw and catch better than any boy on that any of those fields." He wouldn't listen, so I said, "Fine, I'll start my own girls' baseball program." He said, "Go ahead, nobody will show up." Well, I put a notice in the Guilford Gazette school newspaper that said, "If any girl wants to play baseball, show up at this time and place." Well, over 60 girls showed up with mothers and fathers in tow. Now, many had never been taught how to throw or catch. With a lot of training and great coaching, they got to be pretty good. And that was the start of the Guilford Girls Baseball Program. I was notorious for playing unladylike sports. My favorite was football. After getting slammed pretty hard in a football game as a kid, I injured my knee and a piece of cartilage broke off that would sometimes get stuck in my joint and cause my knee to lock when I skied. Very dangerous when you're going 50 miles an hour and you can't bend your leg. I finally got surgery on it at 16. The doctor, Dr. Hoffman, said to my father, "Don't worry, Gus. She might have a stiff knee, but she'll never make an Olympic team." Well, not only did I compete in two Olympics and a world championship, I won two silver medals at the Olympics in Squaw Valley, California, and became the first American of any gender to medal in downhill skiing. Forty years later, that same doctor walked into my office in Laconia and handed me a box tied with a red ribbon. "I was cleaning out my office," he said, "and I found this. I thought you should have it. Happy birthday." I opened the box, and inside was the piece of cartilage from my knee. I keep it in my jewelry box now and prefer it to most of the jewelry. Title IX didn't exist when I was growing up, but I never let lack of equality on paper hold me back. Not from starting a girls' baseball program, skiing with the boys, competing on the world's biggest athletic stage, playing tennis as an adult and becoming the hardcore champ. Oh, maybe I beat somebody that didn't like that. Starting my own travel agency, or even now at 84 years old, leading ski groups to the Alps. Not everyone my age was so lucky. There were girls I knew growing up who were so smart, had so much potential, but just never had the opportunity or access to follow their dreams. I saw so many women trapped in what society let them be, so much wasted possibility and talent. I mean, who knows? I might not only have won two silver medals for skiing, but maybe a medal in shot put or discus too, if Title IX had been around back then. I'm glad that little girls growing up today don't need to confront ornery coaches and put notices in school newspapers to get their chance to play a sport. But unfortunately, too many of them still need to fight for a fair shot. Let's have their backs and cheer them on. Thank you.
Without a doubt, the best part of my job is getting to share a stage with so many amazing women. Dr. Sharyn J. Potter is a professor in the Department of Women's and Gender Studies and the co-founder and executive director of research at UNH's Prevention Innovations Research Center, Ending Sexual and Relationship Violence and Stalking. Dr. Potter is a global leader on the social scientific development and evaluation of bystander intervention strategies. Her work focuses on engaging community members to work collaboratively to reduce sexual and relationship violence, stalking and harassment in high schools, colleges, and universities, and the United States military and her workplaces. Here to talk about the history of Title IX and its future, please welcome my friend, Sharyn Potter.
Thank you so much to the New Hampshire's Women's Foundation for inviting me here today. It's really an honor. And I do have to say, being an academic, it's a little bit intimidating to go between two groundbreaking athletes. So bear with me, I'm not as cool. Okay, so what I'm gonna do is I'm gonna set the stage. It's the early 1970s, and the Equal Rights Amendment to the United States Constitution is gaining momentum. First introduced in 1923, the ERA was designed to guarantee equal legal rights for all American citizens, regardless of sex, in all aspects of life, including employment, property ownership, divorce, and education. In 1972, the ERA was actually passed by Congress, and then it was sent to the individual states to ratify this constitutional amendment. But despite the hard work of so many, the ERA never passed and never became law. Activists and legislators were posed with the question, how could they maintain this momentum for equal rights? The stealth addition of the Title IX amendment to the 1972 Health Education Act at the 11th hour was one of those steps forward. Title IX, as you've all heard today, has changed education history for women, banning discrimination on the basis of sex for any education program or activity that receives federal funding. Title IX also became a path for other kinds of litigation involving pregnancy, sexual orientation, gender identity, and now transgender rights. While the expansion of athletics programs for women and girls is most well known about Title IX, Title IX was actually forced universities to remove quotas that limited the enrollment of women in undergraduate and graduate education. So in 1971, the year before Title IX was passed, only 9% of women had a college education. In 2021, 40% of women have college degrees, and women make up a much higher percentage of undergraduate classes than men. But there's always a but, right? So despite these increased opportunities for women, academic environments were and continue to be hostile environments. In American universities, sexual violence, including sexual assault and sexual harassment, are perpetrated against both women in and out of the classroom at epidemic rates. When we send our daughters to college, 1 in 5 of them will be sexually assaulted while they pursue their undergraduate degree. And these rates have not changed since the first campus prevalence studies were published in the 1980s. When I arrived at UNH, I met some amazing colleagues dedicated to finding innovative ways to ending sexual violence. We formed the Prevention Innovations Research Center and are internationally known for our evidence-based bystander intervention strategies. And in fact, because of our groundbreaking efforts, in 2011, then Vice President Joe Biden came to UNH to announce the Title IX Dear Colleague letter, which expanded Title IX discrimination from educational opportunities to including preventing gender-based violence on college campuses. So this legislation acknowledged that gender violence is a form of gender discrimination. The 2011 guidance was removed during the Trump administration, and Title IX was actually altered to protect perpetrators and limit the jurisdiction of universities in sexual violence cases. But President Biden's 2022 proposed Title IX amendments resolve some of the changes from the prior administration. There is still so much work to do in order to kind of change the shift from compliance to cultural change and to protect transgender rights. And although gains have been made over the past 50 years, gender discrimination in university settings persists. You all might have seen that viral TikTok video from the 2021 NCAA basketball tournament. There was showed a weight room for the male basketball players that had state-of-the-art, super cool weight machines. And alternatively, the female weight room had one small stand of weights, something that one of us would probably buy at a big box store after making that New Year's resolution to finally get in shape. We've all been there, right? So Title IX is not a guarantee. Over the past 50 years, university presidents and politicians have attempted to nullify this legislation, arguing that Title IX would bankrupt universities as they overestimate the amount of revenue that male sports bring in. And also there were the politicians and administrators who were so worried about the opportunities that were being taken away from deserving men. In 1987, President Reagan tried to roll back Title IX, but the House and Senate actually upheld Title IX over the veto of Reagan. So as you all know, women are losing autonomy over their bodies, and our voting rights are being eroded. If we do not vote and hold our elected officials accountable to ensure that the 37 words of Title IX remain the law of the land and add critical expansions to protect marginalized genders from persistent discrimination and exclusion, we will see a day when women will lose their hard-fought gains in all areas of education. So let's make sure that this does not happen. Each of you can take action by sharing what you learned here today, and together we can make sure that Title IX lasts and expands over the next 50 years. Thank you.
You don't have to like how I look.
You don't have to like how I got here.
You don't have to like how I train.
And you definitely don't have to like how I play.
But when you save them in sports,
you support women's sports.
When you hit save,
see.
They see us. Which means we give more support,
more opportunities,
and one step closer to an equal future.
So there's more of us on the court,
on the field,
on the course,
on the track.
You don't have to like what we just said.
Actually, don't like it. Save it.
Save it.
Save it.
Save it.
There's a first for everything, including the New Hampshire Women's Foundation playing a Michelob Light commercial at their luncheon. Remember this day. That video, as you know, features our last speaker, the incredibly talented CeCé Telfer. CeCé
is a Jamaican-American elite athlete who, in June 2019, became the first openly transgender woman to win an NCAA national title. In June 2021, CeCé qualified for the 2021 U.S. Olympic team trials, track and field, in the 100-meter and 400-meter hurdles. Following her victory in the 400-meter hurdles, Telfer appeared on ESPN's Outside the Lines. CeCé has appeared on numerous media outlets and in campaigns capturing global attention in Olympic sports, the LGBTQ community, along with world-renowned professional athletes and Olympians. CeCé was just honored two nights ago in New York City with a 2022 Action Award from Athlete Ally, and we are so thrilled to welcome back to New Hampshire, CeCé Telfer. Come on up.
Good afternoon, and thank you so much to the New Hampshire Women's Foundation for this honor as we celebrate the 50th anniversary of Title IX. Thank you. Legislation that means a lot to me as an athlete, and thank you so much to my family and friends who are here today. It's wonderful to see you guys. I grew up in Jamaica before moving to New Hampshire, and I fell in love with running at a young age. I've remained dedicated to my sport for all these years because it's helped me process my stress and my fears in a healthy, beautiful way. Before the luncheon began, I had the opportunity to meet the Girls on the Run team, as you saw up here earlier, and it's so wonderful to see that the program is supporting them as well. For as long as I can remember, I've seen myself as a girl in the sport that I love. The world around me is still catching up, but I've always known who I am. I am a strong Black woman. I have looked up to other incredibly strong Black women throughout history, such as Harriet Tubman, who didn't stop achieving freedom for herself. She put everything on the line over and over again to bring more and more of her people home to freedom. In 2019, while I was a student at Franklin Pierce University here in New Hampshire, I made history as an NCAA champion, as the first transgender woman to win that title. But I wasn't competing to make history as a trans person. I ran because I love it, and I compete because it's my dream. Title IX gave me the opportunity to compete because everything I've accomplished in my sport has come from painstaking hard work, determination, and like any athlete, a desire to make our school and our teammates proud. I followed every rule and guideline given to me, and still, I experienced a lot of hate and discrimination from athletes, parents, and even a former US president, simply for being who I am. Seeing how the world hates people like me, my dream simply to be the best athlete I can be took on a bigger meaning. When I run, I think about all the kids around the country who wake up every day to news headlines that paint them untruthfully as a threat to women's sports, that ban them from playing sports that bring them joy, like kickball, basketball, or even running track. I think about the fact that the kids who could benefit the most from the life-saving power of sport now has the least access. I think about the ways that running has saved my life, and I want these kids to live. When I speak out about who I am and what my dreams are, I do it because I remember what it was like to hold that truth inside. And to think about my dreams and to think of my dreams were impossible. I know what it is and would have meant to me growing up to see an example of women like me, of athletes like me. I want these kids today to know that their dreams are possible too. I do this for my people, whether it be women, Black people, transgender people, LGBTQI+ people, anybody who's scrutinized and oppressed. All too often, we don't see policies that affect LGBTQI+ people mirroring our own lives and experiences. I'm proud to have worked to dispel stereotypes and educate the public about what it's actually like to be me and compete in my sport. Title IX has allowed me to compete as myself, but there are those who are trying to dismantle that protection, to weaken or even abolish Title IX using fear and misinformation. I will keep fighting for everyone to have the opportunity to participate in sport, but I can't do it alone. We need allies in this fight, and I hope this includes all of you. At the end of the day, I'm just a woman who wants to run. I've had an incredibly difficult time finding a coach to help me realize my dreams of being at the 2024 Paris Olympic Games. I have the talent, I have the drive, and I have the passion. What I'm missing is a coach that sees and values me. We all want to be seen as who we are. What I want most for transgender and non-binary kids out there is for them to see that they can absolutely live their lives and dreams exactly as who they are. That they are there is absolutely a place for them. My ask to all of you here tonight is this: find a way in your own life to bring joy to Black and brown, transgender and non-binary youth out there. So much of society is telling them that they don't belong. So make it a point to show them with action that they do. Think about the children in your own life that you care about. See them as these youths, human beings who, like your loved ones, deserve to be happy. Listen to their stories and what they need. Show up and speak out against discrimination, whether it's a state ban on trans kids playing sports or a hateful remark you overhear. And let these kids know they deserve to thrive. Thank you so much to the New Hampshire Women's Foundation for this honor and for all of the work you do to make sure everyone has freedom and opportunity to thrive. And to everyone here, let's work together until we, like Harriet Tubman, can say, "My people are free." Thank you.
Have a few minutes to have a conversation. I mentioned already we're a bit behind, but we can't miss this opportunity to have a conversation with these three incredible people, don't you think? Haven't they just done an incredible job? So, Penny, I love your spirit. I love the way that you marched right out there and gave your friend a baseball team. You really did. By the way, has anyone watched, what is it on Amazon? Oh, the new A League of Their Own. Have you seen that?
Yes.
That's very good. So, Penny, I want to talk just a little bit about how did it make you feel to have to fight so hard as you did to be able to participate?
Well, you know, when I grew up, this is just the way it was. So I just thought if there were hurdles to leap over. It was just what I had to do. I didn't think that it was unfair. I just, if I saw barriers, I went through them. As long as I didn't go to jail for it, I broke the rules. And I found it was tough to fit in many places, like Middlebury, where I went to school, and I had just come back from having spent 4 months in Europe the winter before, and the first rule at Middlebury was girls could not leave the campus after 8 o'clock. Well, guess what I did? I broke the rules because I thought they were stupid. And now, of course, all the people at Middlebury would say yes, they were, but then I guess they weren't. I was campused for a lot of weeks at Middlebury. I don't know, I guess if I wanted something, I just kept barging through everything and wouldn't stop.
You're an incredible role model. CeCe, how significant was Title IX in your ability to be able to participate in track at Franklin Pierce? And how important was it to not just have legal protections, but also allies in your school?
Thank you for that question. It was very important highlight of my whole collegiate career to have that protection, to have Title IX back me, right? I think that we neglect the fact that Title IX is here to support and protect, right? But we don't see women like me as people that needs to be protected, right? So to have that support and protection at school was huge for me, because that was one of my biggest things is my protection, my safety, and to know that Title IX had my back, my university had my back, the journey was a little bit smoother. My teammates, I thank them so much for, you know, dealing with all the hate and discrimination that I was facing. It's sad to say, they absorbed a lot of that, so I didn't get to see that when we went to track meets or we went to, we were traveling for competition. They were there for me. My university was there for me. More importantly, my president of my school was there for me. So to have that support, I've never really gotten that throughout my life, so to have it at that important point of my life was huge, and it was definitely life-changing and life-saving. So that's what Title IX does. It saves lives. So thank you so much for that.
And Sharyn, you know, we have the bookends prior to Title IX, and now we're on the forefront where CeCe continues to press against, you know, the barriers and the obstacles of finding a coach, et cetera. I wonder if you can talk to us a little bit about where Title IX is going and how do we get there? What's missing now that we're going to need in the future?
So much. So as I said, when you send your daughter to college, there's a 1 in 5 chance she'll be sexually assaulted. And for if you send your son to college, 1 in 8, and transgender students face even higher rates of sexual violence than women. And institutions are not doing enough to protect their students. So we need local, state, and federal legislation that protects our students as they pursue their undergraduate dreams in athletics and academics. I'm also doing a National Science Foundation project right now, and we're interviewing women who are pursuing majors in chemistry and engineering. And there's so much harassment, there's so much kind of like subtle bias, like this isn't a field for girls, where we see we're losing this potential brain drain of women who could really make it in the sciences and other underrepresented minorities. So we're beginning to develop strategies, but there needs to be more money and more opportunities for women and underrepresented minorities.
Thank you for that.
Can I jump in?
Yes,
can I just
please add?
Also, Title IX has allowed me to continue to do what I love and actually like protect me and hold those organizations accountable if they do go counter to that. So I just wanted to add that little part in there. Mm-hmm. It holds mm-hmm. people accountable.
Mm-hmm. Most of the time.
So Sharyn, I'm wondering what you would recommend or advice you'd give to girls and young women entering college.
So I was really
when I was in college, I was actually an accounting major. I became a CPA, but my love and passion was looking to find ways to end sexual violence. I ended up volunteering as a rape crisis center my freshman year in college, and I was really lucky enough to marry my passion, which is ending sexual violence, with my work. So I just feel like as we go as young women and men and enter college, they need to be able to think that just because something's a passion, it doesn't mean that it can't be a career. So I would offer that advice.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. I can't wait to find out what you're going to recommend, Penny. Will you tell us what you want to give all girls out there who look up to you, what advice you would give them?
Well, I would say that everybody has a talent, that talent might be your passion. Without a passion, your passion, not somebody else's, not your mother's or your father's, your passion, if it's really something you want, you go for it. You don't let anybody stop you. I mean, you can do it. And it's just a matter of a lot of hard work. Nobody winds up on a podium without working really hard. Right, CeCé?
Right, exactly.
I mean, it's not very pretty. It looks nice when you're standing up there and they're playing the anthem. But let me tell you, what goes into all of that is a lot of sweat, blood, and tears.
Preach.
So that's what I would say. Find a passion. Then life is wonderful. It really, you got something to do every day. You got to work on this. You got to work on that. And young people, sometimes I don't think they have a passion. They spend too much time looking at their phones.
I'm going to leave that. CeCé, how about you? What advice would you give all the girls and young people that look up to you?
The advice that I would give to all the girls and young people looking up to me is keep going. Don't stop what you're doing. Don't let anybody tell you that you can't do something because you can. There's absolutely a place for you in this world. You just have to take it. Also, reach for your dreams, shoot for the stars, and aim for the moon. You can never aim too high, right? Be the change that you want to see in the world and the voice, and let your voice be heard. And don't back down, never back down. Keep going and do it 100%. The hardest part about losing and being bashed down is getting back up and finishing that race. So when they bash you down, just get back up and just know that that's the hardest part, and keep going, because there's a place for you and you're gonna get there eventually.
I wanna thank each of you. We are so proud to have you be here today to be Granite Staters. Thank you for coming from Los Angeles to be with us. Penny, thank you for taking time out of your busy day. Sharyn, thank you for educating all of us on the many other aspects of Title IX. Again, we are so grateful to you, and we are rooting you on. And sure as heck, we sure hope we're going to see you in the Olympics in 2024.
Absolutely.
Please join me in thanking everyone. Yes. Yes. Thank you. She's going to take a quick photo.
Title IX is one of the most important pieces of legislation of the 20th century. It is a law that speaks to the importance of gender equity in this country.
I pledge to fight for equity and justice.
I took the pledge for the next generation.
I pledge for my teammates.
I took the pledge for women athletes with disabilities.
Will you take the pledge for me?
Would you take the pledge for us?
Why will you take the pledge?
Go to demand9.org to sign the pledge today.
Wow. I feel like I've been overwhelmed by emotion all day long, and it doesn't stop. I also want to just point out two very important things. We have two tables in the back. We keep on recruiting more and more girls to join us at these luncheons. We have two tables from Kearsarge High School who are going to be getting up in a minute to go catch their buses, but I just wanted to thank you
all 20 of you students for coming today. Thank you for being part of this next generation of our work. As we close out our program, I wanted to just share some very brief thoughts, because I know we are past time and we never run long in this luncheon, actually, and we have today, so my apologies in advance. You know, during a time when every week can feel like a roller coaster of rage, despair, triumph, and defeat, it's wonderful to know that we have the power to take really meaningful action towards justice and equity. And I hope that you have listened to the themes today, particularly our last three speakers. Each of us has power as an individual, and it's up to us to use it. But we know that while we have power, our greatest power comes from the collective. You've heard us talk over the last year about our strategic priorities of voice, money, and power. Building these three elements for New Hampshire women and girls is the focus of our work. Our ability to be responsive and strategic in that work is directly related to the strength of our organization. I want you to think for a moment about why it is that New Hampshire needs a strong women's foundation. Think about this moment in time, what it means to have a strong women's foundation. Granite State women and girls deserve to have their voices and experiences amplified. The organizations that serve them need more funding, and our collective movement for gender justice must be both responsive and strategic. You know, in the past six years since that god-awful day in 2016, this organization has more than doubled its budget. We've gone from 3 staff to 7 staff. We've built a research policy and advocacy program, released our flagship research publication, The Status of Women in New Hampshire, and our sister publication, The Status of Girls in New Hampshire. We continue to publish no less than 4, sometimes 5 gender matters. We've created a women-run program, as you know, the state's only nonpartisan training program, which you heard us say 100% of our cohort won their primaries. We continue to help women lead, and we began collecting data this year on the number of women who are running for and or elected at the city and municipal level. Without this data, we know that we can't properly measure, we cannot properly be effective. And of course, close to all of our hearts, we've continued to increase our grant-making program. This year, beyond increasing our scope in dollars, we released 2 new funds, our Reproductive and Sexual Health Access Fund and our Women and Girls of Color Fund. So again, I ask you to think about, what does it mean for New Hampshire to have a strong women's foundation? You know this part of the program. We're all running late today. The program's running long. But this is a moment in time where you get to stop and think for a moment, how do you want to be part of this movement? What is your legacy? What is your impact? Our new strategic priorities of voice, money, and power are launching us into this next chapter, one that will require us to be more bold, more courageous, and more persistent than ever before. And we simply cannot do that without you. So as you all know, part of today is talking about how you can support us so we can better support the women and girls in New Hampshire. In your red boxes on your table, and in front of you, every single one of your place settings is an envelope where you have an opportunity to scan the QR code, write down your credit card number, place a check in the envelope. This work requires financial support. We are the only foundation in New Hampshire, the only organization doing this work. As you grab your envelope or you scan your code, I would ask you to consider again, what is your legacy? What is your impact? What does it mean to have a strong women's foundation? A foundation that's providing accurate and reliable information. A foundation that's training and empowering women to run for office. That is investing more and more dollars in organizations who are supporting the women and girls of the Granite State. We're advocating, we're fighting, we're investing.
What does it mean to have a strong women's foundation in New Hampshire? Your investment in the New Hampshire Women's Foundation today helps us achieve the future that we all want. A future where all women and girls have access to the resources that we need to thrive, where all of us are free to be who we want to be, free of harm, with healthcare access, with education, with economic security. Please take a moment to give in a way that reflects your commitment to the Women's Foundation, that reflects your commitment to this work. Maybe you're ready to become a leadership donor. Maybe you're wanting to give for the very first time. Or maybe you are one of the legacy donors whose current and future support are the backbone of this organization. Each of your contributions matter, regardless of the amount. I want to thank all of you for being here again today, our staff for all that they've done for the past week as we geared up for our first in-person event in a long time, to our sponsors, and again, to all of you for being here. Thank you so much for building community with us today, and we can't wait to see you back here next year. Thank you so much.